I'm Tricia Huguelet. I am the Chief of Pediatric and Adolescent Gynecology here at Children's Hospital Colorado. And I'm one of a four-member faculty team that basically provides care to children and teenagers at Children's with various gynecologic conditions. We actually also, very much our mission is to provide care over a woman's reproductive lifespan. So we also do provide care at the University of Colorado as our patients sort of graduate from this hospital. So the hymen is a band of fibrous connective tissue that serves as sort of the opening to the vagina. And naturally, just before birth, the center of the hymen degenerates so that it's an open membrane. And unfortunately, not infrequently, that membrane doesn't dissolve and it either can be completely obstructed or partially. And it's actually quite common. It can happen in up to 1 to 2% of girls. So a physician should suspect an imperforate hymen. Basically, when a girl at around the expected time of her first period is not getting her period and instead is having cyclic and progressive abdominal pain. That's the most common presentation for a girl who has a completely imperforate hymen. Now, if it's only partially obstructed, what we refer to as like a septate hymen or a cribriform hymen or an annular hymen where it's partially open but partially obstructed, the classic presentation is a girl that either can't place a tampon because there's not a large enough opening, or she's able to place the tampon, but then it gets stuck and she can't get it out, which can be, of course, a very uncomfortable and embarrassing condition for a girl. So we really take these patients very sensitively and try and get them in as quickly as we can to help manage the situation. So the imperforate hymen, it does require a surgical procedure. It's a fairly minor surgical procedure, outpatient, with a very easy recovery and really no long-term implications for the patient. But basically what we're doing is removing that redundant hymenal tissue, whether it's completely obstructed or only partially. What's important to know is occasionally this will present in the newborn period because the membrane bulges when cervical mucus is produced in the baby as a response to the maternal hormones that it was exposed to in utero. And in that case, we'll see it in the newborn, and we don't operate at that point because it's such a small area and the babies don't have circulating estrogen to allow for good healing. So we wait until about the time of expected menarche to do these repairs when there's good estrogen around. In terms of how frequent we see this condition, we operate here at the Children's Hospital basically about every week, and at least a couple of procedures we're performing every month. So it's quite common, and it's not uncommon for me to have several procedures in one day, given the frequency of this condition. So in terms of malformations of the uterus, they're not nearly as common as the imperforate hymen, but at the same time, they happen more than patients realize. If you look at the overall population, it depends upon the population you're looking at. Overall, in terms of the general population, about 3 to 5% of women will have some sort of uterine or vaginal malformation. But then if you look at women who are suffering from late first trimester or early second trimester miscarriage, it may be upwards of 20 to 25% of those women will have a uterine anomaly that's causing the miscarriage. So it really kind of depends on who you're looking at. There are various malformations of the uterus. The external contour of the uterus may be normal, but a septum or wall is running down the cavity, either a complete septate uterus or a subseptate uterus. Those are much more common than when you have only partial uterine development, where there's only one horn, what we refer to as the unicornuate uterus, or even where you have a complete duplication of both uteri, either the bicornuate or a complete uterine didelphus. Those are much less common. And then the rarest condition is when you have complete absence of the uterus, which happens about 1 in every 5,000 women, so not nearly as common. The cause of these conditions is likely polygenic and multifactorial, and so we can't really pinpoint a specific cause. But essentially what happens is at about 6 weeks of gestation, as the baby is developing, the primitive uterus, what we refer to as the Müllerian structures, start out kind of on the lateral aspects of the embryo, and they start migrating to the middle and fuse in the midline, and then they migrate a little bit cephalad to form the uterus and the fallopian tubes, and then migrate caudally to form the lower uterus and majority of the vagina. And anywhere along this development process, an insult can happen that is, like I get said, multifactorial, and when that insult happens, you can end up with a uterine or vaginal malformation. So in terms of how patients realize that they may have a uterine malformation, a lot of patients have no symptoms. The uterus has a wall running down it, but they're still having normal periods, and so they may not recognize the malformation until a miscarriage or even at the time of delivery, at potentially a C-section. But if there is an obstruction, if menstrual flow is obstructed, as can happen with vaginal septums, these girls will present much like the imperforate hymen, with progressively increasing cyclic abdominal pain and the absence of that expected first period. So that's one of the most common presentations. So in terms of confirming the diagnosis, we really try to avoid a pelvic exam in a teenager just because of the discomfort and the sensitive nature of what we're, you know, talking about. So generally we'll turn to imaging and do either 3D ultrasound or pelvic MRI, because these soft tissue structures, they're very minute differences between one anomaly and the next, and it has major implications in terms of the surgery that we're going to prepare and the long-term reproductive outcomes for the patient. So it's really important that we get the diagnosis correctly, which is why we'll do that more sophisticated imaging. It's equally important that we also survey the skeletal system and the renal system, because up to 30% of girls who are born with a uterine anomaly will also have a skeletal anomaly or potentially absence of a kidney. So in terms of the treatment of these conditions, you know, we start out certainly with going through explaining the diagnosis in detail with the mom and her daughter, and then kind of talking about how often we see these conditions, because the girls are really anxious that, you know, is this just me? Why is this happening to me? As a teenager, you just want to be just like your friends. You don't want to be different. And so it's important for us to show that we do this surgery on a regular basis. Although these conditions are rare, we are a regional referral center, and we're operating on these conditions, honestly, on an almost monthly basis. So in terms of this, of the approach for treatment, again, it depends upon the condition. For patients that are born with a septum, there are two different types of septum. There's the transverse vaginal septum, where basically the vagina is obstructed completely across. That is obstructing menstrual flow and absolutely must be relieved. And so for that, we are doing a surgical procedure. Now, it can be a complicated surgical procedure depending upon the thickness of the septum. It may require a special grafting in collaboration with plastic surgery. Depending upon whether it potentially is near the bladder opening, we may need to collaborate with urology. So it really requires multi-specialty collaborative care and advanced planning. So that takes a little bit more time and complexity. And those girls do have to be closely followed by us long-term to make sure the area doesn't restenose and close. That's very different from the longitudinal vaginal septum that runs down the length of the vagina that may be fully open or slightly obstructing. Those are a relatively simple outpatient surgical procedure that we perform in gynecology without the complex planning and without the long-term reproductive implications. So that's very different from the uterine anomalies. With the uterine anomalies, it really depends upon the external contour of the uterus. If the external contour of the uterus is normal, but a septum is running down the middle, then we can easily resect that with a procedure called hysteroscopy. It's an outpatient procedure where we go in and place a camera inside the uterus and then resect that septum. Once that's done, these girls have very healthy reproductive outcomes in the future. And that could be done as an outpatient surgery. If, however, the patient has only a partial uterine development, that unicornuate uterus, or that the uterus is actually almost looks like a deep heart shape, the doubled uterus, the uterine didelphys, those we cannot repair surgically. Those require very careful counseling and close follow-up by a future obstetrician to monitor for potential preterm labor that can be associated with those conditions. The reason that it's important to consider Children's Hospital and our care for these patients are really twofold. First of all, these conditions although they are more common than women realize, they are still what we would consider a more rare condition. And without a good volume and good experience, you may mistake one malformation for another. And that has huge implications in terms of the correct surgery and the correct surgical technique that really requires somebody who's doing these procedures on a regular basis. And here at Children's, we see these patients a lot. Separate from that is, you know, it's our pride and joy to take care of teenage girls, girls who are at such a vulnerable point in their life, and they need a lot of emotional support and counseling to know that they're not alone, and that with appropriate treatment and expert guidance, they can have regular periods, pain-free periods, and the potential for healthy pregnancies in the future. So in terms of our approach with these patients, we definitely provide a multidisciplinary approach. One of the foremost important aspects of care, as I mentioned, is the emotional support. And we have a wonderful team of behavioral health specialists and a specific provider who this is all that she does, and she really enjoys taking care of these girls. And I have had such wonderful feedback from my patients regarding her care. And I hear from patients all the time that that was the most important part of their care, was getting the opportunity to really talk with her and recognize again that they're not alone. And in addition to the psychological support, we absolutely rely heavily on our other surgical subspecialties, including the urologic team, the plastics team. As I mentioned, sometimes these procedures require grafting. Sometimes these procedures require vaginal molds that the urologists are very experienced in and also help us sort of manage the bladder and the bladder opening that are very close to the vagina, because of course we want to do everything with the least surgical risk and the best surgical outcome. And oftentimes to get that, because of our subspecialized training, it requires collaborative surgical care. So we routinely will operate together to get the best outcome for the patient. One of the important aspects of the older adolescent's care is that transition to adulthood, and where is she going to receive that sort of expert care and knowledge. And we basically provide patients with two options. One is that they can continue care with us on the adult side within our clinic. But for a lot of these patients, they have wonderful relationships with their pediatricians and with their gynecologists in the community. And in that case, we collaborate, we reach out and we tell them and kind of guide those physicians. They may be very comfortable managing these conditions, but if they're not, we'll provide the guidance so that they can continue to manage those patients in their own practice.